One, two, three, go.
I got it.
All right, we got it. Hi, I'm Roman Loyola from Macworld. I'm here with Intel processor guru from PC World, Gordon Ma'ung.
Hey.
Hey, we're here to talk about the new MacBook Pro, which is right here, the one in front of Gordon. This is
It's
last year's model, just to point
officially
out.
controversial now. Officially
Yes.
controversial MacBook Pro 15 now.
Yes, we're here to talk about the controversy, as Gordon points out. So there are apparently some thermal issues with the new laptop that affect performance.
Right.
Dave Lee, a YouTuber who does these great tech videos, he did a review of the 2018 MacBook Pro.
You found it to be faster than the old model?
He did not find it to be faster than the old model, but a lot of it has to do with these throttling thermal concerns. So we thought we would do some of our own testing to see. I asked Gordon to help out since he knows Intel processors back in like the back of his hand. But yeah, be sure you check out
PC person.
Dave Lee's video on YouTube. We'll have a link to it.
But
But anyways, right now, what are we doing, Gordon?
so I think the thing is what we want to add, because the final word is not going to be done today or this weekend.
Yeah.
We want to add nuance to what's going on here. Because if you're the kind of person, and I'm a PC person, but if you're the kind of person that's going to go MacBook Pro 15 2018 with the new Coffee Lake processor, Core i9, Core i7 is slower because it can't handle the heat. Yes, sometimes, but a lot of the time, no. And in fact, the takeaway is this laptop, in a lot of tests, is still faster than this laptop. So do not think this thing is just universally going to be slower
Right.
anytime you heat it up. Oh, it's hot, it's going to be slower. That is not true. In
Yeah, it
fact,
all
we're showing
depends.
that now, right? We're showing
Right.
that.
So right now we're running a test. It's called Corona. It's a 3D rendering test.
Corona is I think it's a ray tracer test. You can
Right.
download it for Mac and PC and run it on your own machine.
Yeah.
It is a pure CPU test. It is multi-threaded, so the more cores you have, the better performance you get.
Yeah.
Right now, we kicked it off, if you saw in the beginning, at exactly the same time, 2018 MacBook Pro 15 Core i9 CPU, 2017 Core i7 Kaby Lake, 16 gigs,
2.9.
16 gigs
Yeah.
of LPDDR3, 32 gigs of DDR4.
Yep.
Memory difference does not make a difference in this test as far as memory capacity. It probably will not affect much of the performance overall. It's all about the CPU. It runs maybe 3 or 4 minutes while we're talking,
Yeah.
but we already know what the result is because we've run it,
We've
and
run it a
this
couple
one
times.
is much faster. It was like two. What do you have the numbers there, I
Yeah,
think.
so it was our results for this one on Corona was what 2,205,800 rays. Is it rays
Rays per
per
second,
second? Rays per
2.2
second.
rays per second, 2.2 million rays per second.
Right. Whereas on the this laptop is 1.5 million rays per second.
Right, so
So
1.5 million versus 2.2, that is the kind of uplift you expect, honestly, to get from going from 4 cores to 6 cores, and we're seeing it. Now, I think one argument people are going to say is like, well, this benchmark is 3, 4 minutes. It's not enough to heat that CPU enough
Right.
to where the performance drops. And you actually did a different test using
So,
Blender, right? So
right.
Blender's a free open source render, very popular. A lot of movies have been made with it.
Yeah,
And what did you
so
get?
we ran Blender. It's the gooseberry test, and I got a 20%. Our preliminary results are that the new laptop was a 20% improvement over the old laptop.
And I think Blender's important, or Gooseberry's important if you've never done testing in Blender, because it doesn't take 5 minutes or 10 minutes to run. It
It
takes
takes about an hour on this laptop, about an hour and 15 on this laptop.
Right.
So this one finished already.
Oh, it's done already. Oh,
So
okay.
maybe you can talk about the squiggly line.
Oh, the squiggly line. So, this is the frequency. Now, again, this is 2.2 million on this, much faster than 1.5 million. But this squiggliness is sort of the issue here. It's basically the clock speed of this laptop bouncing up and down. Whereas you look at this Kaby Lake, it's just a
It's
nice
just
flat line.
flat.
So what happens on this laptop? It starts reaching a power limit, a thermal limit. It starts getting hot and it gets off the gas. Clocks drop down, temperatures go down. it gets back on the gas. So it's constantly just bouncing back and forth as they are hitting the gas to try to keep the CPU cool enough and consuming enough power to run within this laptop. Yeah. But still, 2.2 million versus 1.5 million. And again, and you saw in Blender, in a 1 hour load, so a 1 hour CPU load, where you would expect the performance, the clock speeds of this thing really to have issues. It's really gonna sort of drop down because it's been running for an hour. So you build up a lot of heat, the clocks are gonna drop, but you still saw 20% more performance in Blender. And I think also in V-Ray, we also ran another, Chaos Group has another Ray Tracer benchmark you can download as well. You got to register for it, but you can download and run that, and I forget.
Yes, and we found that this, the new laptop, was 12% faster than last year's laptop. So during the Corona test, I wanted to point out that this laptop, the fan kicked in. This laptop, it did not kick in at all.
Right. And so it's interesting to me because it just shows that this one is probably within the power constraints, thermal constraints of this. With this new 8th generation parts, Intel has really swung for the fences. They really like to run them at very high temps, very high wattage. And when you get to a laptop this thin, it's actually pretty tough.
Yeah.
Now, I'll say, when I went to the original Intel event for the Core i9 laptop launch, a lot of the Core i9 laptops were like this. This is an Acer Predator Helios 15. Great gaming laptop, I think. I haven't tested it yet. But this has a Core i9 in it with a high-end GeForce graphics card, a 1080, 17-inch panel. But, you know, the big thing is it's thick. You can see how thick this is. If you look at the bottom.
It's got fans galore on the bottom.
You've got massive heat pipes. You've got a lot of cooling. This is what I always thought Core i9 was intended for. And then I started to hear after that event, soon after, people were like, oh, we're going to put them into thinner, smaller laptops. I was like, really? I thought it was like a highly overclockable, high-end performance part. You're trying to put them in laptops to thin. I got to say, I know as much. There's like, oh, that's not going to be great. This is not a good look. But I'm going to think we're going to see similar issues on other Core i9 laptops that are just super thin. It's really hard to manage the cooling on this. Sorry, I need some coffee. Well, so clearly, if you are, but the takeaway is, if you are doing CPU constrained tasks, like a lot of 3D rendering, a lot of 3D modeling, I think definitely you're still getting performance out of 6 cores that you're going to get over a Kaby Lake quad core.
Yeah.
Right? So, I mean, we've done 3 tests and definitely does do that. There was time though where I think Cinebench underperformed what we expected it to.
Right. So we also did a Cinebench, the CPU test.
Right. So we use Cinebench, which is another, it's made by Maxon. It's another 3D renderer.
It's different from, so Cinebench offers 2 tests. One is an OpenGL test. The other is a.
Yeah. And then you can also, another thing that's really cool about Cinebench, what I like to do is you can say, use all 6 cores, use all 12 threads, or use 1 or 2.
Yes.
And we actually did a single threaded run in Cinebench on both of these laptops right after we had finished a previous encode, really long encode. And I was blown away because the MacBook Pro 15 was, I think it was 130?
It was 130. It's interesting because we came with the first result that we had was 130.
Yeah.
And then the second result that we had after letting the laptop sit for a while and not do anything.
Maybe 5 minutes, 5, 10 minutes.
Not very long. It was above 160.
Yeah, so 160, and which is pretty much what you got
which
out of
which is what we got from this on a consistent basis. We got on the old laptop, we got a score of 160 on a consistent basis.
But I got to say, I mean, even that, so that is, it just sort of tells you about the variability of performance you may see out of this laptop in even lightly threaded tasks. If this thing is really warmed up, the performance might kind of stink for a little while. So,
what about real world video tests like Dave Lee's?
Yes, so that of course is the premier pro elephant in the room, right? So you want to bring up what he did?
Yeah, so Dave Lee did a Premiere Pro test where he rendered out a video, but the details of his project probably a little more intensive than what we have around here.
Right. So he took a Scarlett W 5K video encoded out, and he saw 15% less performance on the new 6-core MacBook Pro versus the older 2017 MacBook Pro 15.
Yeah, and our results, we found that we found a 5% difference, but it was a 5% speed increase of the new laptop over the old laptop. Now, again, our project was a lot different than Dave's project.
It was lower res. We used 4K Sony Alpha footage, about a 5-minute video project. In fact, if you can go watch the video, it's the iPhone 10 camera shootout.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a real video.
It's
not made up. It's not just created just to test stuff. It's an actual project that Adam Murray did. Good looking video. Go watch it. YouTube. Yeah.
So we need to look into that a little more. We need to do a little more research into that and see what kind of projects we can pull.
Right. But I do have some theories from that, though. So we, so from the premiere protesting we did, we also, one thing you should know is Premiere Pro renders on the GPU primarily. A lot of the load will get pushed off to the GPU. These both have the same Radeon. So we also did a Premiere Pro render test using just the CPU. You can do that by switching to the Mercury software engine. And that basically does all of the rendering on the actual x86 cores in here. And the results we got?
So it ends up being, the test that we did, this the new laptop finished in two minutes before the old laptop.
Right.
It's not a big difference.
Not a big difference, and actually that does get, that does reinforce exactly what Dave Lee ran into, which is doing that rendering test, there's times where it's just going to be, the performance is not going to be that much better.
Yeah.
So that is, I got to say, that is a very disappointing number. I also do think some of his results are even worse because he used a combination, I'm going to believe, of GPU and CPU. But the design of this laptop and most thin laptops uses one single cooling mechanism, a single heat pipe that also cools the GPU and the CPU. If you start heating up the GPU, you don't have as much cooling headroom for the CPU, and the performance of the CPU may drop or the GPU may drop depending on which one it is. Also, there's power constraints too, but I do think there's a lot of perfect storms you can hit into.
Yeah.
May not have been, with Premiere, definitely some encode tasks that use GPU that it just may not be pretty.
Right.
It just may not be pretty a good look.
So with all that under consideration, I guess the question is, who should buy a Core i9 MacBook Pro?
I would say probably a few people should buy the Core i9 version.
So.
I would say Intel has this chip, Coffee Lake H, that's in the laptop. There's a Core i7 that has 6 cores, and there's a Core i9 version that has 6 cores. The Core i9, again, you saw, was sort of made for those great big gaming laptops. I think if they were my money, I would definitely want the 6-core Core i7 version. It's got lower clocks already, so you're starting from not having to push it as hard. So the performance, you still have the same cooling system, but I do think you're going to get the best performance out of the MacBook Pro platform 15 from that Core i7 6-core.
Core i7 6-core.
I mean, because a lot of people are going, "Oh, I want the old version now." I'm like, I got to say, no, I don't think so. I just don't think. I don't think you really want to go backwards to that if you could get it anyway.
Right.
So there's a lot of advantages to the new version too, right?
More cores is always better. So
more RAM.
There's also the issue of software optimization. We haven't tested Final Cut Pro.
Yes.
So Final Cut Pro probably blazes on these machines.
True, but you still have the problem of heat. There's going to be a lot of heat from the shared heat pipe design, which, again, this is not unique to Apple. There's a lot of 15-inch laptops that use a single shared heat pipe for both discrete graphics and the onboard. So else? I think a lot of people want to know, like, is there anything that can be fixed? Is there a software fix for this? Is there anything Apple can do to improve the performance of it or fix it?
Right. So, well, there's a third-party software. Hopefully, they'll update their software to take advantage of the new processor. On Apple's side, what does it come down to? It comes down to being able to, maybe a firmware update.
Yeah. So, what Apple can do is they can say, "Hey, we've heard complaints. All right, you don't care about noise. You got this new laptop." They can push out a new firmware update. What happens is then the fans kick on a lot sooner.
Right.
It'll be louder than it was before, but then you'll get better performance.
Yeah.
More heat means more noise means,
right,
more performance.
What about the future of this particular design? Apple's trend has been towards thinner and lighter.
Right.
You know, and I don't really see them stepping back and saying, yeah, we're going to make a bigger laptop.
Can they make
to accommodate this processor in particular? So
I don't think that's in Apple's DNA, but I could see. Couldn't you see everybody's been saying, let's see a 17-inch MacBook Pro, right?
I was a big fan of the 17-inch MacBook Pro, and I miss it. So, but I'm also a big guy who doesn't mind carrying around a 17-inch laptop. So,
right. They could also, I suppose, redesign the cooling system in this. They may have to make it look a little thicker, but they could separate a lot of gaming laptops. The graphics card is separated from the CPU, so they don't heat each other up as much. So it wouldn't interfere as much, like I think what we're seeing in a lot of the Premiere render tests. Another thing they could do is to use higher quality thermal paste or thermal adhesive material or whatever they're using between their cooler and the CPU. Go to a higher level on that. There are things that definitely do help.
Yeah. So.
But that's about it besides redesign, and fans louder. Not sell the Core i9 version, maybe, but, you know, and I got to say, you know, to be fair to Apple, there was a high-end version of the same overclockable CPU available, which today would be a Core i9 in the previous version laptop, too, because people wanted that CPU. Right. And I had my doubts of whether they could have kept that as cool as they did. So,
So where is the story going, Robin?
So we need to do a little bit more testing, but because it's such a hot topic, we wanted to chime in and let you guys know what we were thinking and what we're doing. So hopefully we'll have some more results for you guys to look at, and we'll have an update to our Core i9 review.
Right, but you're in no way saying this ain't no problem sweeping on the rug.
This is definitely something we should investigate. It's definitely not something we're ignoring. We're taking a look at it. We're going to take a look at it and take a look at the numbers and go from there. So
stay tuned to macworld.com for more.